Next on Nebraska Stories, a shipbuilder crafts an homage to his father. An iconic painting gets a facelift. A very Hallmark Christmas in David City. Overcoming challenges to achieve greatness. And honoring a blues legend in clay.
Larry Bowers is building a ship. He's not doing it from memory, but from memories.
Dad never talked about actually working on the boat. He would talk about some of the fires and that the boat was involved in.
Larry's dad, Len, worked on a real-life fire boat, the LA City No. 2, near Los Angeles in the San Pedro Harbor. Len Bowers and the others aboard helped to pull water from the harbor to help put out fires on the shore.
He joined the fire department in October of 1941. Of course, Pearl Harbor was in December 41. And I think he stayed on the boat until the end of World War II when he was transferred to a traditional fire station in Los Angeles.
In the early 2000s, the boat was retired. Larry purchased plans of the ship to build a model for his dad, but that didn't happen. His dad passed away in 2012.
I got some drawings from the fire department, and I was thinking of building it. My dad was still alive. He was in his late 80s at the time. And life got in the way. I just never got around to it.
Larry eventually got to see the boat at the Los Angeles Fire Department Harbor Museum during a trip to California with his brother. He learned the boat was being restored, but no one would be allowed below deck where much of the work took place. Larry made the museum an offer.
I said, I'll build it and give it to him, but I'll do a cutaway showing the what's called the engineering spaces below deck, the engines and the pumps and the piping and all that really neat stuff. And he said, sure, go for it.
Larry's model building work in the basement of his home started with lots of research.
I might spend 2 or 3 hours down here building something, but I might spend 2 or 3 hours upstairs on the computer. I correspond with the folks at the museum. In the last 6 months that I've really been building this thing, I bet we've exchanged 300 or 400 emails. I need a piece of information. They'll go out to the boat and they'll actually look at it, measure it, or research their archives, and they'll send me the information back.
Building the model is almost as detailed as building the actual boat, right down to the rivets.
So every 18 inches, there's a series of rivets, and I have about 14,000 of these little rivet impressions put in the boat.
From the water pumps to the fire hose reels, no detail is too small to be included.
The engines are so intricate. There's spark plug wires, there's carburetors in them, there's fuel lines, oil lubrication lines, oil filters.
Larry even used 3D printers to construct copies of the engines to ensure they were exactly identical. Looking back, the entire project could have been overwhelming.
If you think about this thing as an overall project, you'd probably give up before you even start. The way I approach it is, everything's just a little project. You get the engine done, you get the pump done, you move on to the next thing. You don't think about a whole bunch of stuff down the road.
His work on the model kept him busy for several hours each day, and that was just the time he spent in his workshop.
The crazy thing is, I might be out mowing the lawn, but I'm thinking about how I got to do something. So it's, you know, I might be or walking the dog, and I'll all of a sudden, hey, I can make this part this way or that way, and so my mind's always kind of churning through how to build something on the boat.
Now, after 10 months, his masterpiece of a model is complete.
I step back and go, wow, that's cool.
Larry's been building models of boats since he was a young child. He thinks this one will be his last, and
by far, it's my best.
He'll eventually make the trip to Los Angeles and donate the boat to the Fire Department Museum.
Like any of my models, I love looking at them when they're done, but they sit here in my basement and me and the dog look at them and don't pay any attention. So I'm glad this is going to be someplace where other people can see what it looked like.
In all, Larry has invested nearly 900 hours of work on this 4-foot memorial to his dad, who he believes has been with him through it all.
Yep, I think he's looking over my shoulder. I'm going to put a dedication, like a little plaque on there, you know, dedicating to him, showing his picture, and I think that'll be pretty cool. I just wish he could see it. I just miss talking to him. So it's... I'm sorry.
This model of a boat 1,500 miles away from nearly 80 years ago is bringing this son and his dad a little closer.
He'd like it. Yeah, he would be really happy.
Let's start with the painting. It's called The First Homestead, and that's what it depicts. The artist is Gusto Strohm, who lived in Beatrice near the site of Daniel Freeman's homestead claim. Painted in 1888, likely working off a photograph.
It's a very honest attempt to reproduce what we know of the first homestead.
The painting took a beating, for a while tucked behind a door in a U.S. congressman's office, before landing in Kenneth Bay's lab at the Ford Conservation Center. There are problems like large tears and small holes, a brittle canvas pulling loose at the edges, and lots of dark grime and soot.
Remount, clean it, make it brighter, fix the holes, varnish it, all in the next month.
All in the next month, you'll see a big difference. We want to, number one, make sure that work of art survives past our generation and forward into the next generation. But we also want to make sure it's presented in the best way possible as the artist would have originally intended. So here we have the canvas, which has now been removed from its old wooden stretcher. I've also prepared these areas where there were tears and the canvas was buckling with weights where I've had overnight flattening going on so that we can now line the painting and have these tear areas aligned properly.
Adhesive is helped by a heated table and vacuum to attach the painting to a new reinforced canvas.
So I'm about to start cleaning this painting.
Getting rid of decades of exposure to black soot.
This darkening of the picture has sort of illusionistically compressed the image. We no longer have that sense of space that the painting was meant to have at one time when you looked at it.
Bay's also filling those tears in the canvas.
By varnishing, I'm adding a protective layer, but aesthetically, I'm adding a layer that fills in that finely pitted surface and gives a nice even saturation and a slight gloss to the painting.
This will bring out some of the color, some of the feel.
Not only will it even out the sky, but it'll especially saturate and darken all the dark foreground terrain.
How hard is it to match that color?
What I actually see is not just one color, but it's a whole sequence of colors. I'm trying to create the same illusion that the original painting has of layering little wisps of color. And I'm using pigment and paint medium, which is easily removable.
That, plus a lot of testing, provides a safety net. But to me, working on another artist's creation, owned by someone else, would be nerve-wracking.
One of the skills that I've developed is knowing what not to do, knowing the battles to pick, knowing where to stop and knowing my limits. And even conservation can have limits. And so we owe it to the artist and also the owner of the work of art to know what we can't do for them. So that's how I stay out of trouble.
So you're done?
Yes, the painting treatment is finished, and now we can see it much better as it was originally intended.
Gusto Strohm's The First Homestead leaves refreshed for display at the Homestead National Monument. Bay moves on to more paintings in need of new life.
I think art conservation is very important because we only have the material heritage, the artwork, the historic artifacts that we inherited, that have come to us down through history. I love it. I love art conservation, and it's what I do.
Just the general vibe, the electricity in town has been so exciting to see that.
Hey, ho, ho, ho!
You know, everybody has really come together. We're even just seeing people collaborate more.
Christmas has come to David City a little early, all thanks to a little known piece of history.
We are the birthplace of Joyce C. Hall. He was born in the late 1890s and actually lived here to about 10, 11 years old. He is the founder of Hallmark Cards.
Hall eventually moved to Norfolk, where he opened his first card store. In 1910, he moved to Kansas City. It'd be another 18 years before he'd found the company we know today as Hallmark. And though Hallmark is a highly recognized brand, their founder's connection to Nebraska isn't widely known.
I believe I've heard that there was a sign out on the highway right when you come off of Highway 92. And I think it was worn and disrepair that it has been taken down. So our next objective is to really highlight those that are from David City.
Hallmark Channel presents 10 years of television's biggest, most successful holiday tradition.
That history brought the Hallmark Channel, a national cable network that features Christmas-themed movies during the holidays, to David City as part of the Hallmark Channel's new Hometown Christmas initiative. The company showered their founder's boyhood town with the Christmas spirit by donating money for decorations.
We were looking for a way to give back to communities, and bring communities back together, and give people as much joy and spirit as they give us at Christmas. So we thought that David City would be the best ever first stop for Hallmark Channel's Hometown Christmas, which is what we call this program.
Hallmark's special recognition of the town inspired people from all over David City to give their time and talents, turning this holiday season into something much larger.
I'm on the Ag Society for here at Butler County, and so we kind of help with the shuttle parkings out at the fairgrounds, and the restrooms are open out at the fairgrounds. And we both work in David City, so different portions of our jobs have filled the streets, I guess.
The town has gone through some difficult circumstances recently. The local Fargo assembly plant shut down, and nearly 200 people lost their jobs. The early Christmas event gave the town something to celebrate.
Just seeing the whole community come together, it's been a long process for the whole week, and so to finally see it all in production and done is going to be great.
It's not just the adults who got in the Christmas spirit. Even pets got in on the action. The event brought people from all around, nearly doubling the town's population of 2,900.
We actually live in Omaha. We thought it'd be a really fun opportunity to come out and see David City, and it was a good time just to get in the car, take a drive out here, and we, as a family, really, really enjoy the holidays, and so it's kind of like, why not get this kicked off early? It just seemed like a really good idea.
Up until now, David City wasn't famous as the home of Hallmark's founder. But their early Christmas celebration brought nearly 5,000 people to town, and the Hallmark Channel spread the word to many more. The publicity even attracted one very special visitor.
Santa is making his very first visit of the Christmas season here in David City tonight.
Santa Claus is coming to town. He's checking it twice. He's gonna find out who is naughty and nice. Santa Claus is coming to town.
It appears the people of David City not only put together a celebration of the holiday.
Two, one.
But of this small town's can-do spirit.
Jobs are hard to get. I know people looking for work all the time. They can't find work. I had an interview somewhere. Can't remember where it was. And I know what the problem was. It's my disability. People got disability and they don't hire people. People with a handicap, they don't. You gotta talk to Jane. Don't talk to me.
Not better. You're gonna walk. That's 5 miles from your house.
Oh, I need exercise.
It was a citizen advocacy program where you pair up. And the words we used at the time were advocate and protege. We're just friends. And we've been friends for 35 years.
Everybody in here that has known Steve, he's like family to all of us.
He's simply Mr. Reliable.
Steve is a man of routines, so he gets here every day about 4 o'clock. And I think he's happy to come here because this is a place he's been coming to for so long and he knows all the people here.
Well, good morning, Cliff.
I think we kind of hit it off and we've had a good rapport ever since. We both like to kind of tease each other and we've got that built up over about 9 years, so it's a rich experience, I guess.
Do you think the show's good enough that they're going to make a second season?
I hope they do.
He has a good character, he has a good attitude, and I'm proud to know the guy. You know, I'm proud to kind of share an hour every day with him and to be a part of his routine and to have him as a part of our routine.
It can be pouring, it can be 10 below zero or 100 degrees, and Steve walks every morning to work. He reports, I think, around 5:15. It doesn't matter. He's going to get here one way or another.
I think that's remarkable given Nebraska's winters, especially, and blizzards and so forth, but he makes it through, and he's here, and he's on time, and he's not ruffled, and the rest of us have had to scoop our cars out of the snow and so forth, and it's sort of a nice feeling to come in and everything is kind of on the even keel with Steve.
I'm going, oh boy, what happened here?
If everyone in this building had his work ethic, they would get so much more work done. He doesn't stop. You can't get him to take a break. He wants to be here. I think this is his family, this building and the people that work in this building that he's known for years are part of his family, and I'm happy to be one of those.
Hopefully I've been that for Steve, someone he can always count on. I can't say there's anything I said or did that helped him out. I think if anything did, it was the Goodwill's program that enabled him to be independent, have his own apartment, not be on any public benefits, and have a retirement account and all those things that go along, having his own apartment, getting his own groceries, living his own life independently as he wants to live. That's done most of it. I really do think if it weren't for Goodwill, is the one constant in his life over the 35 years, 37 years I've known him, that has enabled him to get where he is at now. The Goodwill Industries International Achiever of the Year Award, and that means international, worldwide.
The joy that you have brought to all of us and the inspiration you brought to all of us. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
He sort of realized that what he was doing was really good stuff for us.
We're all happy that he's receiving this kind of recognition.
And out of 500 applicants, 500 people applied for that award as the Achiever of the Year. And Steve was the one that got it because of his history and where he began and where he ended up and his accomplishments over the years. That was quite a moment for Steve, where you're in front of 500 people and you're up on the microphone. And so we had kind of written a speech out ahead of time. And he said, Jim, can you read it?
Steve is shy. A little shy, but in addition to being such a good worker, so committed, having such a high level of common sense and integrity, Steve also is good at dictation, at giving dictation. And so Steve asked if we would say this, basically.
Everybody in the room gave up and gave him a standing ovation, and it was just a highlight of his life, and it was just all he could do to keep from busting into tears. It was just a really neat moment for him. For as far as he's come, as lonely as he's been, to be there and receive that kind of inspirational accolade, it was a wonderful thing to see. You don't realize the time goes by, then all of a sudden the time's gone by and you've been friends for nearly 40 years. Something inexplicable, but when you sit down in a room with him and talk with him for a few moments, you know, and get past a bit of the shyness, then you discover this is one really neat guy who just brightens up everybody's life. And it's really hard to put into words the why. Other than that, I think he's a joyful guy because he gives joy.
We're doing a series of medallions for a recording company in Indiana, a pioneer of early recording.
It's all of the musicians that they covered, and they're wanting to do a walk of fame to commemorate what was recorded and the types of music that were recorded in this area.
We're doing Coleman Hawkins, Duke Ellington, Fats Waller, Lawrence Welk,
Hoagie Carmichael, Louis Armstrong, King Oliver, just a whole group of people.
Who's the cowboy guy?
Oh, Gene Autry.
Gene Autry. We did Gene Autry, for crying out loud.
The guy that we're working on right now is Blind Lemon Jefferson.
His body of work influenced most of the blues and rock and roll that we listen to today. And most people haven't heard of him. He was a great guitar virtuoso to begin with. And then he had about a 2-octave range in his voice that could either just knock you right on your back or lull you to sleep.
What I primarily do is get the imagery going. The whole time I'm doing this, I'm thinking colors. I'm looking at the facial features. I'm mapping out lights and darks and shadows and changes and thinking how light would hit them if they were on stage. This is my working pattern for Blind Lemon Jefferson. So each piece is numbered and it also has a color on it. The idea here is to think about who these people are, who they were, what they brought to us musically, and to make them come alive a little bit. Just get the face right. You get the face right, you get the eyes right, everything cooks.
The style that we're working in is almost a stained glass motif where each feature has its own shape and color. And that's how these murals are put together. There may be 2 or as many as 300 parts in one of these murals as tiny as a pinhead, it doesn't seem like that would be significant, but it is. The process isn't rocket science, but it is, you know, science. It's a combination of ceramic and bronze. The center of each of these medallions is a label that this artist recorded under. A mold is made and wax is poured. And those are then cast in bronze.
Ready?
I have a personal relationship with this guy. I know him. And of course I don't, but I have some ownership here.
People say, oh, well, you know, ceramics, that's just craft. Well, it's not. Craft has function, but God, there's some beautiful function going on out there. It's not just a craft, it's an art.
For me, it's even an extension of what these artists did. I'm part of it. Some of them more than others, but each of these guys, now I'm a part of this process.
Watch more Nebraska Stories on our website, Facebook, and YouTube. Nebraska Stories is funded in part by the Margaret and Martha Thomas Foundation.